Hello and welcome to the very first edition of this brand new Fordham Basketball Rebounders Club podcast. I'm your host, Andrew Bogusch. This is one of the many initiatives of a recharge club. We look to support both basketball programs here at Fordham as much as possible. The connection between the teams and the coaches and you, the fan base, can always be stronger. Our goal with this podcast is to get you an inside look at the program, the players, the coaches that represent Fordham on the floor. There is so much more available at reboundersclub.com. With that all being said, it's time to introduce our very first guest on this podcast in year five in charge of the men's program here at Fordham. In between a win over Maryland Eastern Shore and a visit from Manhattan this weekend, it's head coach Jeff Neubauer. Coach, thanks so much for making time today for us. We appreciate it.
Well, Andrew, thank you. And obviously, that was a very good start to this podcast. I'm glad I had nothing to do with it. That was very well said.
But now it's all on you. So yes, I'm going to sit back and you can just talk for 15 minutes. Yeah. Seven games into this new season, five wins for you guys. Just kind of an overall grade for your young men so far this season.
Well, I think you have to separate different sides of the ball. And so defensively, we've done a lot of good things, and that's always our focus. That's where we begin when we talk to our team. So, you know, I think we've done a very good job. What is that, a B-plus maybe?
Sure.
We've got to get better. Offensively, it's a work in progress. And so we really have spent more time this year talking about playing inside out, throwing the ball into the post. That has received or created mixed results so far. We've got to get better scoring in the post. That will open up other people.
On the defensive side of things, obviously, as you said, it's a good start, but what are you looking for? What's next on defense? Maybe there's a particular, you know, a goal or a stat in mind. What do you have? What do you want the guys to do next?
Yeah, so in a big picture sense, when the season ended last year, we showed them where we were nationally defensively. And we were good last year defensively. And we showed them what VCU had been 2 years ago and how they had progressed and become the seventh best defensive team in the country. And that's how they became an elite team in the Atlantic 10 a year ago. So big picture-wise, we are absolutely telling our team we've got to become one of the 10 best defensive teams in the country. Our defensive numbers to this point have been very, very good. We are limiting three-point shots. We are turning people over. We're doing all the things that we need to do. But now the consistency of communicating on the court, the consistency of blocking out has to go from a 40% to a 60%. Everything has got to get better. Our guys do understand the principle, and they understand the importance of defense. Now we've got to gradually improve in all the little elements.
Now on offense, there are some new faces from last year. Obviously, there are guys who are playing more than they did last year, or maybe there's more focus on them offensively. So what's the next step on that side of the ball for your guys?
Well, certainly Chuba has improved.
Yeah.
It's showing up. It's, you know, it's been very good for our team. He's 13 points a game. He's very eager offensively. And so far, that's been good for us. I really felt during the offseason, talking about the spring, the summer, that Onyi Ayisi was the most improved player in our program. And it was a strong feeling I had. That hasn't really become evident yet during games. And I think it will. I think Onyi is going to be one that really can lift our team in the months ahead. The one other guy that's really going to improve as this season goes on is Gazi, right? Mm-hmm. Erten Gazi. He is such a dynamic player. He's got a strong physical body. He can do so many things well. I've kind of limited his minutes to this point, and as he continues to improve, Gazi's going to make a big difference for our team.
Those minutes limited because he does have an injury history both at DePaul and here. You're just kind of protecting him at this point?
That is part of it.
Okay.
That's for sure. And he really hasn't played much basketball in
almost three years, right?
Yeah, exactly. 3 years is better. I was going to say two and a half, but you're on it. And so, I think sometimes in those situations, it's better to gradually work a guy in. When I say he hasn't played basketball, you know, the year that he transferred here from DePaul and sat out, he didn't practice one time all year. So mm-hmm. He was injured that whole year. Last year, I think he played in about five games. So the answer is gradual is better as we work Gazi back into our rotation.
We're coming off the Maryland Eastern Shore game. From our vantage point, it looked like Joel Soriano had his most impactful game. Maybe there's a different game that stands out to you, but what's a fair expectation for him as a freshman?
Gradual progress. So Joel, he comes to Fordham with all the tools. He's long. He's got big hands, long arms, athletic, all the things that you would want out of a bigger player. And so now it's just adjusting to a new level of basketball. He has competed before getting here to Fordham at the highest level internationally. He's competed at the highest level prep school-wise. Here in New York City, playing at Stepanak, yeah. He's competed against really good players. So all of those things go into who he is right now. However, it's a different level. And so really pleased with how he played on Sunday. He did take a good step. We did see some really good things from him in our scrimmage at Army, which was probably a little bit over a month ago. So we've seen signs, and he's just going to continue to get better.
The last guy I wanted to point out particularly here is Yvon Rodd, a big freshman year, maybe a step back last year, last couple of games, struggling to knock down his shots. Where is his game? What are you guys working on to make him that three-point weapon he can be for you guys?
Well, Yvon certainly was our best shooter throughout the preseason. If you were to pull up our practice stats, percentage-wise, he is by far our best three-point shooter. So you're right. He hasn't made any in the last couple games, but we do think it's there. That is the one way that he really feels that he impacts our team. Something I've really been trying to promote with him is his effort to rebound at both ends. He's done a really good job in practice the last couple days of really being an impact around the rebound, you know, around the glass. So I think Yvon can help us in a lot of ways. He certainly does view himself as a shooter.
I think he had 4 assists on Sunday too. So I mean, there's that as well.
Yeah, he did, and he's done a lot of different things during his career. If
yeah.
you think back to his freshman year when we played Manhattan. I mean, he was hitting 15-footers at the free throw line. He was attacking the rim. He has helped us in a lot of ways. A lot of people do stereotype him or fit him into that small box as being a three-point shooter.
Let's talk big picture now as we get deeper into this year. What are the goals for the rest of this month? All home games, Manhattan coming up first. Where do you hope to be when 2019 becomes 2020?
Yeah, so, you know, again, coach speak.
Yeah.
You know, one day at a time, mm-hmm. one game at a time, all that. You know, I think the most important answer is, so obviously we have to make progress, but offensively, you know, we're going to have to really spike here at some point. And so when I say that, I'm always talking to our team about defense, how the importance of defense, you know, it's the most important part of who we are in Fordham basketball. All right, that's got to improve. Like, that's non-negotiable. We have to become an elite defensive team in the country. With that being said, all right, so where are we going to improve offensively? Is Onye or Joel going to be able to score consistently in the post? Where do we really make that progress at the offensive end? Because so far we've been a little bit hot and cold, inconsistent.
Walk us through the way you constructed this non-conference schedule, what you had in mind, the way you line teams up, and being at home basically the entire time. What was the kind of overall theme for this fall?
Yeah, so there are a couple ideas. First of all, the first thing we have to do here, you know, at Fordham is we've got to win. We have to create a winning demeanor, a winning attitude. And so to do that, we need to win games. The other part of that is coming off of last season where we really struggled down the stretch. I mean, the Atlantic 10 slate for us was really difficult. A lot of them were close games. We lost a number of games by 3 points or fewer. But with that being said, when you come off such a tough finish to the year, you've got to try to build confidence. You got to give yourself opportunities to go win games, and so we've done that.
Manhattan's coming up next. Obviously, as a different focus from the fan base for a game like this to battle the Bronx, do you change your approach at all to give a game like this any more importance to the guys as you're prepping for it, or is it just another game?
Well, we certainly prepare them for what it's going to be. And what I mean by that is, you know, if Manhattan were a rival or if they were a team from 1,000 miles away, their style of play is very unique. And what I mean by that is they're very physical. They play really, really hard. They dive on the floor more than any team you'll see all season. They take charges as much as we do.
Yeah.
It's a very tough-minded game. It's a very physical game. You know, obviously they foul more than anyone else in the country. So, like, you just have to prepare your team for what the game is going to be. It's not as much, you know, the fact that Manhattan is 4 miles away. It's simply the idea that, hey, you better be ready to play because the other guys,
yeah.
the guys wearing green, you know, they're ready to start a fight.
But, you know, you've got players from Europe. You've got Josh Colon from Puerto Rico, like guys that might understand Fordham versus Manhattan. So is there any kind of like almost educational preparation for a game like this?
Well, you know, the play that defines the series since I've been here is from my first year when we had four guys ejected from the game, you know, where Waterman tackled Mandel on the layup. So, you know, as far as preparation for the game, yeah, guys need to be aware that they can't step on the court if something like that happens. They need to be aware that this is there's intensity involved in this game. So, yeah, I mean, that's where I've only been here for 4+ years. But for me, that's one of the two defining moments in this series was us having – I think it was actually 5 players ejected in the first year.
Right. I guess along those lines, but whether it's Iona or St. John's, Hofstra, Stony Brook was now on the football schedule here. Is there any desire on your part or their part to have more of these kind of rivalry games on the schedule?
Yeah, well, in my mind, you know, one of the moments that I really felt great about was that first year when we did beat St. John's. Mm-hmm. And it was actually within a week we played St. John's and Manhattan. I thought it was a terrific week. So we are
Mandel dunk against St. John's. I still remember.
I do remember that one. Yeah, it was in such a tight space. Yep. He dribbled around. It was one of the best basketball plays I've seen in a tight space. But to answer your question, we are always open to playing St. John's. We want to play St. John's. It's not our choice that we're not playing St. John's. And, you know, I do think we have played most of the local teams. We haven't played Iona during my time here. And I don't know how many years it's been since Fordham has played Iona.
Yeah.
But to have Rutgers come in here last year, obviously Columbia came in here last year. You know, we've played as many of those local teams as we can.
Are those games important to recruiting New York City or Long Island or wherever, you know, New Jersey? Do you need those games to help, whether it's draw attention or, like, you know, further kind of solidify the program in the area? Does that help you to all keep local kids around?
You know, my answer, Andrew, is I don't know.
Okay.
And yeah, you're probably right. I'm not sure.
You know, Joel, I think part of the, obviously from the talent standpoint, there's one thing, but him also being local, as you pointed out, seemed to be a big coup for you guys. Do you hope, does one recruit open up the door to others when you're working in an area?
Well, you know, having Chuba here on the team, he's from the Bronx, and not only is he from the Bronx, but he's such a personality that everyone who plays basketball here in this area knows who Chuba is, and that's whether they want to know him or not. I mean, he's got that personality. So, you know, I do think Chuba has been, you know, he's been in contact with the recruits. He could be a little bit of a Pied Piper, but you're right. Joel's a talented guy, and, you know, whenever you sign a local player, it can be the best thing for your program. It can open up many other doors, and hopefully that's the case.
We've kind of gone over this, but I guess when we get to Atlantic 10 play and the focus shifts to conference games, you know, how does that change maybe your approach, you know, how you prepare guys and how do you get them ready? I mean, that first game is at VCU. So what are the A-10 goals for you and your program?
Yes. All right, so as far as goals, I mean, what we're trying to do is we're trying to accomplish things that have never been done in Fordham basketball history. That's something that I've used for probably all 15 years that I've been a head coach. All right, so what do you do on the way to accomplishing things that have never been done? You've got to accomplish things that haven't been done at Fordham in a long time. So, you know, we started the season 2-0 this year, and first time in over 20 years. We started the season 3-0 this year, the first time in 47 years. So that's what I talk to our team about. I talk to our team about, hey, we've got to take these steps. We've got to accomplish little baby steps. We've got to do things that haven't been done in a long time, and that will lead to bigger things.
Pick a guy on the team. Tell us something about one of your guys that we don't know about that's maybe not basketball related. Maybe somebody's funny, does impersonations, can sing, or anything like that.
Yeah. So the personality of this team this year is incredibly unique. And the two newer guys that have added so much to our personality, Josh Colon and Joel Soriano, those guys do not stop talking. All right? I asked one of our players yesterday after practice, I said, how many clowns do we have on this team? And he literally named those two guys. I mean, we've got two guys that are absolutely, if there's no conversation going on at a pregame meal or on a bus, those two guys are going to start the conversation. Mm-hmm. Chuba has been the personality of our team, but our personality is growing.
Do you obviously chemistry is important, but how much better can chemistry make you on the floor in your mind?
So I think the most important part of it is it can help you through good and bad times. So does it help you, like, make a shot? Yeah, sometimes, you know, like if you're really playing for your brothers. Mm-hmm. Does it help you guard a little bit harder? Absolutely. But also, you know, I think guys can keep each other pointing in the right direction if you win three games in a row, if you lose three games in a row. You know, I think that connectivity really, really matters.
And a trip to the Paradise Jam, you guys had a good time except for your hand injury.
Yeah.
But, I mean, that I would think, too, is on top of the games, being together for a week has to help you chemistry-wise, too, right?
I totally agree. And, you know, the thing I was really thinking about as we flew back up here to New York, I mean, we spent six straight days together.
Right.
So we
not at the beach, I heard.
Well, some of us.
Yeah, kind of. Yeah.
Yeah. But, I mean, we had every meal together for 6 days. So we spend a lot of time together throughout a season. We're on buses and planes, mm-hmm. You know, practice, film room, weights. We see each other a lot. For those 6 days, it was nonstop that we were together, and that does nothing but help.
What is the diagnosis on the hand? How much longer?
Well,
until you're back to normal.
Yeah, they tell me I'm going to be wearing this splint for another month, which,
okay.
Yeah, I can't believe it. You know, the doctor popped it back into place. Let's go.
Yeah. You know? Who threw the ball? And did he have to do any suicides? Is that a thing? Or
let's just say that he is still employed.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, so it was not a player.
Well,
a staff member.
I actually didn't know at the time who threw it, mm-hmm. but later versions of the story, none of the players wanted to take credit, and we'll just blame it on Herschel Jenkins.
Fair enough. Coach, this was awesome. Thanks so much for spending the time with us. We appreciate it, and good luck this weekend.
Thank you, Andrew.
So our thanks again to Coach Neubauer for joining us here on our very first edition of this brand new Rebounders Club podcast. So much more information about the club doing so many great things here. This new season begins at reboundersclub.com. Our goal with this podcast and so many of our new initiatives is to bring you behind the scenes so you know more about these young men, these young women, and their coaches as we head towards conference play. So once again, thanks to Coach Neubauer, and we'll see you soon inside the Rose Hill Gym. I'm Andrew Bogusch.